set is the new record for the highest score I've ever set on this channel in Game 6 over the Golden State Warriors capturing an NBA championship. There's a championship in Toronto! If you've never watched before, hi, my name is Steve Dangle, and as you can tell, there's a lot of hockey stuff in the back. That's because
Shut up! I'm talking about a win!
A team wins for once in my life and you're texting me?! Sorry, where was I? I talk about hockey for a living. I don't usually talk about hockey unless the occasion warrants it, and I would say winning the NBA championship warrants it! I'm hyped! The whole city, the whole region, the whole country is hype, can you tell? Raise your hand if it hasn't sunk in for you yet. Not at all. And listen, I'll address something that I said in the last video in case you missed that one. Bandwagon, for sure. But here's an idea. Shut up and let people enjoy things. I've always liked the Raptors, but I haven't been, like, a fanatic. And for the Raptors fans who have been fanatics since day one, since as long as they can remember, this is for you. This is for the whole city. This is for the whole country. We all enjoy this, but the true hardcores, I know how special this is for you. I might not know a ton about basketball, but I know a lot about covering sports. I saw it firsthand in a hockey-mad city like Toronto, in a hockey-mad country like Canada. It was difficult for people who cover basketball to sort of get a foothold, to really establish themselves. And the true hardcore basketball fans in the industry helped carve out a niche and make it into the monster that it is today. And to the hardcore fans, you did this too. Half of the fun of sports is being able to talk about it and experience it with others. Well, that had to be pretty hard if there weren't any other hardcore basketball fans around you. I was a little kid, but I still remember when the Raptors came to Toronto. I think I was in grade 2, and I want to say in the spring of grade 2, our class was discussing two things. Mighty Mouse, Damon Stoudemire, and the introduction of the Toonie. And who would have thought about a quarter of a century later how closely the number 2 and the Raptors would be linked. You hear that, Skip? Look at you. But that was only the beginning. Listen, a big theme about this Raptors season, especially this Raptors playoffs, is all the things that the Raptors and this fan base in particular have been through. Because they went through the struggles of being an expansion team, but that comes with being an expansion team. And they weren't very good, but that's because they're an expansion team. For the longest time, the greatest win in franchise history was a regular season win against Michael Jordan and the Chicago Bulls. And then the Vince Carter era. A legitimate superstar in the sport. That dunk competition, man, I didn't know you could do the things that Vince Carter did, and I didn't know it was possible to make Shaq make that face. It really looked like they were building something, a winner. And then we all know what happened. The graduation, the missed shot, the no more dunks.
Rafael Araujo.
The trade. Alonzo, good morning, Alonzo, good night. And the smoldering rubble that remained. Those were lean years.
Hey, we get the first overall pick!
It's Andrea Bargnani. Chris Bosh with the ball in his hand looking around like, help me! Now the one good thing to come out of that is Vince Carter in that era started a fire. They inspired a generation of basketball fans in this country and the sport spread. Not that people weren't already playing basketball in Canada, they were just playing it more. But be that as it may, as positive as that is, the team stunk. And even when the team didn't stink, they didn't have a legitimate chance of winning. But there was this one kid, went by the name of DeMar DeRozan. Quiet, unassuming. I saw him in a store once. No one was bugging him. Oh yeah, I heard he's supposed to be pretty good.
Well, he better be good if he's gonna have to play for the Raptors.
Bosh leaves, and then the tweet. Don't worry, I got us. No, it wasn't like they got great right away, because you might remember that it looked like the Raptors were gonna try to tank to get Canadian Andrew Wiggins with the first overall pick by trading their star player, Rudy Gay. And somehow they turned that into over half a decade of consecutive playoff appearances, where they lost in the first round a lot, to Paul Pierce mostly. It's okay, this year we're playing a different team, there's Paul Pierce again! But then they end up winning a series. And after a while, you know what, hey, they won a second series! They're off to the third round! Cavs in 3! But Bismack Biyombo said no. But after they fell in 6, it looked like Kyle and DeMar and company were building on something. So last summer, if anyone outside of Toronto was like, why the heck are Raptors fans so upset about the Kawhi trade? It's amazing. DeMar meant something to this franchise. It's a market where no one stays. And I think a lot of Raptors fans had no faith in the Kawhi trade because guys have been traded to the Raptors before and just refused to show up. And after the sweep at the hands of Cleveland and LeBron again, things seem bleak. Then it's like, all right, it sounds like DeMar really likes it here. What about everyone else? How long until everyone starts asking out of town? DeMar can't do it on his own! If you watch all the hype up videos, the theme of this season, heck, if you listen to Masai Ujiri's press conference introducing Kawhi Leonard and Danny Green, he said,
Believe in this city. Believe in yourselves. When you've been burned so many times, it's hard to think that way. And so much was promised. Oh, Kawhi's a top 5 player in the league, and Danny Green's great, and this and that. Oh, they got a real shot at the title, maybe, sorta. Or at very least, a real shot at making it to the final and getting crushed by Golden State. And we're talking about believing in ourselves. DeMar was the first player to actually believe in this city. So a lot of fans were gonna hate this trade, or at least be skeptical of the trade, until they saw the results with their own eyes. And it was weird, right? Kawhi comes in and... you see this guy? He's pretty good. And there were some nights fans are like, alright, let's watch me some Kawhi. Load management. And again, we go back to the hockey thing and, oh, rough and tough and you lay it all out there for your team. Load management. But you know what? They win some games. Actually, they win a lot of games. And they make another trade where they get rid of a bunch of guys that fans love. CJ Miles, DeLon Wright, Jonas Valanciunas. But Marc Gasol's pretty good. And they win even more games. And they head into the playoffs with the best thing you can hope for in what is going to be a 2-month war. A shot. A legitimate shot at a championship. And I was there. I was there for game 1 of the playoffs against the Orlando Magic. And they lost. Kyle Lowry, 0 points. Watching him brick those 2 free throws was one of the most unbelievable things I've ever seen. The whole building, and I would know, I was sitting in the last row, wanted him to just one. We knew he had 0. Both! So they lose that game, and Terrence Ross leaves Scotiabank Arena with the Raptors' lunch money. And I just couldn't help but think, okay, you know what, they might beat the Magic, but they're not beating anybody else. But the next 4 games, oh! Game 1 against Philly, oh! They looked like an unstoppable train. Then games 2 and 3. But still, the Raptors fought on, and Kawhi Leonard was a star on the court like I've never seen in this city before. Like, one of the things I've seen discussed is, you know, Josh Donaldson won MVP while he was with the Blue Jays, right? It's different, man. It's just different. The way Kawhi controlled games when he wanted to control them is something I've never seen before. Game 7 comes. It looks like they got it. Jimmy Butler. And with 4.2 seconds left, I'm just getting ready for overtime. Ah! That was my reaction at home. I have friends who were at that game and they said that half the crowd, ah. But... the Canadian call was great, but the call from the Americans is unlike anything I've ever heard in sports. I've never heard both the play-by-play and color commentator just abandon all everything and go, aah! And it's amazing when in the moment, while experiencing it, you realize you're witnessing something iconic. The 4 bounces, the crouch, the roar of triumph so loud you can see the blue Gatorade on his tongue. People are talking about it the next day. People are talking about it that night, calling it the shot. For years to come in Canada, you're gonna be talking about the shot and everyone's gonna know what you mean. But still, and this is very Toronto sports of me, something lingered. I saw the shot. I saw it with my own eyes. I saw the pictures. I saw the shirts, the merch. I wanted to get a poster of the ball hanging in air over the rim and hang it in the house. But there's something about me because I'm weird, and the Leafs did it to me, I'm sorry. I couldn't help but feel that for years to come, I would see that photo in my house, and I would fondly remember that moment for a moment, and then remember, oh, but then they lost and didn't win the championship. Listening to people, oh, I don't know, Milwaukee's pretty good. We talk about Kawhi, this unstoppable monster when he hits the court, and then we got a glimpse of the Greek freak. I hated Brook Lopez after game 1. Raps lose game 2 as well, and I somehow get my hands on tickets for game 3. It's funny, because Kawhi was obviously the MVP all playoffs long. Siakam was an amazing story all season long. Norman Powell and Fred VanVleet especially really came into their own in the Milwaukee series. But that game will go down as the Drake game. Man, I was sitting up in the nosebleeds and I'm like, is Drake on the court? Giannis is bricking 3 throws. I'm like, what's going on? I don't care what you say, man. It legitimately played a factor in the game. Granted, the Raptors bricked a couple free throws of their own and that ended up going to double overtime, but they won that game and game 4. But the fact of the matter was they were gonna have to go into Milwaukee and beat Milwaukee there. And it just didn't seem like it was gonna happen. But no matter how much the Bucks got up, the Raps never seemed out of it. And they somehow did what no one was able to do and beat Milwaukee 4 straight. But then the Raptors end up where a lot of people thought, best case scenario, we thought they would be up against Golden State. Where everybody was like, yeah, wow, great run, and the trade was totally worth it and all that. They're not going to beat Golden State, even without Durant. Game 1 in Toronto, by the way. Siakam has a huge game and the Raptors win. But something haunted me about that. Again, I'm a scarred sports fan, man. The fact that people called that win convincing. 118 to 109 was the final score. And I'm like, convincing?
Listen, I'm no basketball strategist, and I'm definitely not a mathematician, but that's 9 points. Which for Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, and Golden State is 3 baskets. And if you gave him 60 seconds, they could probably pull it off and still have some time left over for a couple shimmies. Sure enough, right down to the wire, Iguodala in game 2, or as Max Kellerman calls him, Iguodala. But then game 3, 123-109? That's convincing. 105-92? That's convincing. The team's firing on all cylinders. Danny Green is back. The team's defense is great. Jeremy Lin is in this series. And Durant comes back. And he lights the Raptors up. Until his ankle literally explodes. Literally. You've all seen the video. It's literal. Golden State ends up pulling off the 1-point win, and I couldn't help but feel like, oh boy. I'm like, I don't know. It's really tight, but I feel like they're gonna come on later in the game. Steph Curry and Klay Thompson are nightmares. They need a millisecond and zero space to drop 3 right in your face and maybe even draw a foul. And then Thompson goes down. And we're all having moral conundrums. Just watching that play, I thought he just banged his knee, and then they showed the replay. It's not supposed to go that way! And everyone had just finished yelling at Raptors fans because of the Kevin Durant thing, and some fans cheered, some fans didn't. So I'm just staring a laser beam into the TV like, I hope he gets better soon, and also his team loses. And then he walks off the court, and I'm just sitting there like, I am not happy that my team has gained an immeasurable competitive advantage. And then the camera's not on the tunnel, but you hear the crowd go nuts, and I'm like, what? And then he starts walking down the tunnel, and I'm like, what kind of WWE bullshit? And he hits both free throws and, oh, okay, he's gone again. But I'm also sad. I'm sad. I'm sad that he's gone again. That's how I'm supposed to be. I'm supposed to be sad. Fred VanVleet with the Nelly Band-Aid on his face from when he got cracked in the face with an elbow catches fire. And the Raps needed someone because it was unreasonable to expect Kyle to keep up the pace of the first. Golden State was unbelievable under their own net. Kawhi being Kawhi. A chance to put it away. A turnover! A Curry shot! No! A brick! A rebound! A timeout that's not actually a timeout! The Raptors win! No, they don't! Okay, let's win it again, apparently. All right, all he's gotta do is hit these 2 free throws, and if he only hits 1, it's possible they tie it, and if he doesn't hit any, it's possible they lose. Cool! And 4, what felt like the second time that night, the Raptors win! From start to finish, their season was an amazing story that I'll never forget, the city will never forget, the country will never forget, and now, the world. It's different, man. It's just different for a Canadian team to do this in this league. It means more to do this in a league that Americans, by and large, actually care about. You know, don't be arrogant about it, eh? You know, be polite. But we're here, and it feels awesome. Questions. If Kawhi leaves, will you be disappointed? Yes, if the Toronto Raptors' best player leaves, I will be disappointed. But that whole he stay thing, if he stays, great. If he doesn't, best of luck, man. With this championship, it doesn't matter who Kawhi Leonard plays for next year. He will be a Toronto Raptor forever. You know what? It'd be great to build this super team, this dynasty that wins several championships. It'd be great to be the Miami Heat of a few years ago, or it'd be great to be Golden State of now, basically, until either of them runs into Kawhi. But the Raptors wanted a championship. And they got it. Whether he stays or goes, I still say he should eat for free. Him and his uncle. What was going through your mind when the turnover happened with 9 seconds left? Yes, get it, Spicy! Something like that. Does seeing Toronto celebrate make you that much more amped for when the Leafs win? Because I'm so ready. So ready. When. I like that. You know what? I'm excited for the Leafs to win because they're my favorite team. Maybe it'll sink in more and I'll have more of an idea after I go to the parade on Monday. So I don't know if this makes me more excited for the Leafs to win because I don't know if I could possibly be more excited. I just want them to get out of the first round. But I tell you what, the Raptors give me optimism about the Leafs. They give me a new perspective. Holding on like, oh no, I like this guy. I like this player. Bold moves need to be made if you want to be a champion. That, more than anything, has got me excited. What the hell is wrong with Skip Bayless? Sodium. Look, man, we gotta stop giving this guy attention. I was sending him some tweets last night. We gotta stop. He's not even doing analysis. He's doing entertainment, which is fine. I think entertainment belongs in sports, for sure. But he's not even saying stuff that he means. He's just being a heel. He's like a professional wrestler without the flips. I don't think it's particularly hard to do what he does, either. All you gotta do is pick what's popular and be contrary to it. What you do need for that, to his credit, is a thick skin and also a complete lack of self-respect. Entertainment belongs in sports. Even cartoonishly goofy fun belongs in sports. I just can't get behind his shtick, dude. And I saw some people say, oh, I bet Kawhi is happy to rub that in Skip Bayless's face. I don't think Kawhi thinks of Skip Bayless at all. Kawhi Leonard thinks of 2 things, winning championships and apples. I gotta do this last one in selfie mode on my phone because I've been talking so long that my battery died. A lot of people ask this question,
Do the Warriors' injuries taint the victory?
Well, when you talk about it for years to come, they're noteworthy for sure.
And I saw a lot of salty people say, hey, well, you know, if Klay Thompson doesn't go down, and especially if they had Kevin Durant, they'd probably win.
And in that moment, I realized it was appropriate that people used to call the Raptors the purple dinosaurs.
Because for that scenario that you're talking about where the Warriors had absolutely zero injuries, all you need is your imagination.
Warriors would have won if they had KD. Yeah, and if I had wheels, I'd be a wagon. The Raptors can only beat the players that are on the court.
They did, and it was awesome. So that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Never done a video where the battery just completely died before. Because the Raptors are champions!